继立场新闻上个星期三宣布停运之后，再有网媒宣布停运。众新闻话，传媒生存环境恶化，冇办法再毫无担忧咁达成理念，将会喺星期二开始停运，网站唔再更新。黄俊谦报道。
成立五年的众新闻透过社交平台专页发表停运声明，声明话一直热爱这一片土地，但无奈当下面对的不单只是风吹雨打，而是龙卷风吹袭。过去两年社会巨变，传媒生存环境恶化，令他们没办法再毫无担忧地达成理念。声明又形容公司是身在风眼的小艇，在风高浪急的当下情况严峻，在危机中必须先确保船上人的平安，宣布将会在星期二起停止营运，网站不会再更新，一段时间之后将会关闭，衷心感谢订户和读者的支持。众新闻在2017年1月1号由前明报总编辑刘俊涛等多名资深传媒人创办，记协前主席杨建兴担任主笔，当时他们说对本港新闻自由状况深感忧虑，希望众新闻可以传承专业新闻精神，回归新闻初心，为公众利益和公众服务。 NTV 记者黄俊谦报道。
网媒众新闻话，传媒生存环境恶化，冇办法再毫无担忧咁达成理念，宣布星期二起停运。本港新增26宗新冠病毒个案，17宗系无症状感染。法甲巴黎圣日耳门公布球星美斯确诊感染新型冠状病毒。各位欢迎收看这节新闻。继立场新闻上个礼拜三宣布停止运作之后，再有网媒宣布停运。众新闻话，传媒生存环境恶化，没办法再毫无担忧地达成理念，将会在星期二起停止营运，网站不再更新。黄俊谦报道。
成立五年的众新闻透过社交平台专页发表停运声明，声明话一直热爱这一片土地，但无奈当下面对的不单只是风吹雨打，而是龙卷风吹袭。过去两年社会巨变，传媒生存环境恶化，令他们无法再毫无担忧地达成理念。声明又形容公司是身在风眼的小艇，在风高浪急的当下情况严峻，在危机中必须先确保船上人的平安，宣布将会在星期二起停止营运，网站不会再更新，一段时间之后将会关闭，衷心感谢订户和读者的支持。众新闻在2017年1月1号由前明报总编辑刘俊涛等多名资深传媒人创办，记协前主席杨建兴担任主笔，当时他们说对本港新闻自由状况深感忧虑，希望众新闻可以传承专业新闻精神，回归新闻初心，为公众利益和公众服务。Now TV 记者黄俊谦报道。
翻嚟 Now 早晨，国新办邀请多个专家解读早前发表的《一国两制下香港的民主发展白皮书》，重新新选举制度先至适合香港，投票率不反映制度好坏，香港过去的选举亦都是不正常的，而香港要实行怎样的制度，取决于中央怎样主导香港的民主发展。驻北京记者吴嘉敏报道。
新选制下的立法会选举，90位议员产生，同日国新办发表《一国两制下香港的民主发展白皮书》。在北京，法学者认为新选举制度正本清源，确保爱国者治港的原则，强调香港以往的选举都是不正常，西方一套的民主只是害香港。
竞争的激烈程度啊，它不亚于过去，是吧？我们看到这次这个落选的，是吧？那好多我们也觉得人家应该选上，咱们没选上，对吧？他也没有祝福名单，是吧？这个大家都在同一平台上，就是比政纲、比经验、比能力、比爱国爱港，是吧？像过去选举都是比怎么去啊，这个能反中乱港就能选上，对吧？那这不正常嘛？两年来中央所做的一切事情都是为了挽救香港、挽救青年、挽救民主、挽救一国两制，一切都是为了香港好。
投票率只有大約三成，是回歸以來最低。另一法學者認為，投票率的高低不反映選舉制度的好壞。
投票率的高低不一定意味着选举的民主性和正当性的一个判断和效果。将投票率和民主性和正当性直接挂钩，或者把它等同起来，我认为至少是不符合法治和民主理论的。我们只是把投票率作为一个选民参与政治表达意志的一个指标啊，不能只看说啊多少人投票，也要看啊投票选出来的候选人是什么。
多名專家多次重申，白皮書是要還原歷史真相。香港在殖民時期並沒有民主，中央才是香港民主的推動者。現在的選舉制度來之不易，香港亦都付出了高昂的學費。
至於何時會普選行政長官，王振文說基本法規定的雙普選目標沒有變，會按照香港的實際情況出發。 Now TV 駐北京記者嘉敏報道。
詳細新聞內容，立場新聞多個高層和前高層被警方公安處拘捕，涉嫌串謀發布煽動刊物，並且被凍結6100萬資產。據了解，創辦人蔡東雄正被通緝。立場新聞宣布即時停運，遣散所有員工，昨晚11點移除網站以及社交媒體所有內容。立場新聞的網站到昨晚11點只是上載停止運作公告，提到因為多個高層以及前高層被捕，即時停止運作，包括網站以及所有社交媒體在內，所有內容已經移除。立場新聞在昨日下午宣布停止運作，即時遣散所有員工。他們的辦公室昨日下午解封之後，部分員工仍然未離開。副财主陈朗星话：尊重公司停运决定，
要尊重公司嘅决定啦。我冇其他补充啦。今日系好伤感嘅一日。多谢大家。
警方公安处寻日拘捕七个人嘅行动，由陈浩伟报道。
请问警方呢个系乜嘢行动？系咪？
立场新闻处理总编辑林少彤朝早大约6点被警方国安处人员上门拘捕同搜屋。据了解，警方喺佢屋企检走电脑、平板电脑、电话、记者簿、旅游证件等等。佢之后被锁上手铐，带返立场新闻位于观塘嘅办公室协助调查。国安处禁止传媒上楼拍摄，喺大厦外边划出传媒区。行動中，警方派出200個軍裝和便衣人員，獲得法庭搜查令，授權搜查和檢取新聞材料，亦都搜查了被捕人士處所。在立場新聞辦公室搜查超過5小時，檢走多箱物品，包括多部電腦由貨車運走。林少彤亦都被押離辦公室。被捕的還包括立場新聞前總編輯鍾佩權、前董事周達志、吳可兒、方敏新、何韻詩。另外，還押中的前《蘋果日報》副社長陳佩敏早上亦都在大欖懲教所被捕，他涉嫌有份參與立場新聞撰文，串謀發表煽動刊物。国安处人员朝早亦曾经带同法庭首令去到立场新闻副采访主任陈朗星位于大围的住所搜查，说他涉嫌串谋发布煽动刊物，并阻止他拍摄。
他讲的。
是。
由
警务官办所
差
办公。
是啊。为什么直播是不可以录影呢？为什么不可以直播呢？
大约一个钟头之后，将陈朗星带嚟住所。
大埔，大埔，
登上私家车前往大埔另一个住所继续搜查。逗留超过3小時，警方检走他的船接和记者证等等。
不需要担心我啦，我未被捕嘅，我亦都佢连协助调查都冇讲到嘅，咁啊就系话嚟搜屋。立场新闻一向都是做专业的新闻报道，这个是毋庸置疑，大家全世界的人都有目共睹的。无论是其他乜嘢罪名，其他东西都不能够改变这个事实。
他相信拘捕行动和记协无关，只是针对立场新闻。Now TV 记者陈浩伟报道。
国安处高级警司李桂华说，立场新闻不断刊登煽动文章，引起对政府憎恨，而公司被冻结6100万资产是国安法下金额最多的一次。警方说，立场新闻部分资金流往伦敦分社是调查方向之一。于俊报道。
警方国家安全处话，立场新闻涉嫌在2020年7月至到今年11月刊登多篇煽动性文章和新闻报道。
中大嗰个例子，咁你睇咗咁耐嘅新闻片，你睇咗咁耐嘅审讯，有冇听过话警方系扫射、开枪扫射一啲嘅示威人士咧？又冇听到其中话有啲嘅警察咧系去烧晒啲人咧，去烧毁啲嘢咧？唔見㗎喎，咁但係呢啲係好有煽動性嘅嘢嘅，聽咗之後呢啲人都會好覺得哇，你啲警察係做啲咩嘅呢？
李桂华举例其他涉案文章曾经提及抗争者被失踪、被侵犯，同埋形容审讯结果是中共赤裸滥用权力、隻手遮天，而被捕人对立场新闻编采同埋公司策略有重要角色。半年间，苹果日报同立场新闻高层被捕，公司停运。被问到传媒日后报道制裁等新闻会唔会违法，李桂华话：传媒识得分。
你访问个人，跟住你又好同情佢啊，又好赞成啊，佢做得好啊，又好感谢佢嘅做法啦、啊。咁甚至喺自己个文章入边都写埋咧，我同佢嘅睇法咧系完全一致嘅。咁呢一个咧，我觉得就唔单止净系去一个报道嘅情况啦。呢个已经系完全支持咗，系透过嗰个受访者嘅言论咧，系去要嚟咧系说一啲嘅说话出嚟。希望大家唔好誤會，我哋絕對唔係去針對任何邊一行、邊一業、邊一種嘅機構，只不過係針對一啲危害國家安全嘅行為。
保安局局長根據國安法實施細則，凍結立場新聞6100萬資產，係金額最多嘅一次。警方話部分資金流往立場新聞倫敦分社，會係調查方向。
依、這個網媒啊，佢係以報導本港新聞為主嘅，又點解需要一個英國嘅分社呢？他們究竟有沒有合謀其他人去做一些危害國家安全的情況，包括是勾結外國勢力等的罪行。
至於轉載立場新聞會不會犯法，警方說要視乎意圖，呼籲市民不要陷入危險。 Now TV 記者於俊報道。
歐盟和聯合國人權辦公室對香港警方國安處拘捕立場新聞的高層或者前高層表示關注。外交部駐港公署回應說，任何外部干預抹黑都注定失敗。歐盟對外事務部發言人斯坦諾透過社交網站指出，香港警方有關行動顯示香港的新聞自由進一步惡化。聯合國人權辦公室亦都發聲明，對香港公民空間持續遭到打壓感到擔憂，說香港有法律責任尊重信息、言論和結社自由。德國外交部發言人就批評香港警方的行動，再次證明香港的言論以及新聞自由持續遭到侵蝕。外交部駐港公署發聲明，對歐盟等的言論表示強烈不滿和堅決反對。發言人說，有關言論肆意詆毀香港法治和自由，妄圖阻撓特區警方依法執法，又說任何外部干預抹黑都是不自量力，注定失敗。
case cannot be erased. Taken down under the cover of darkness, boards were erected around the monument, which was then covered up. 8 meters tall, the Pillar of Shame depicts 50 torn and twisted bodies piled on top of each other. It symbolized lives lost during the military crackdown on pro-democracy protesters in Beijing's Tiananmen Square on June 4, 1989. But since October, it had become an issue of dispute, the university demanding it be taken down. In a statement, they said, "The decision on the age statue was based on external legal advice and risk assessment for the best interest of the university." They added, "The university is also very concerned about the potential safety issues resulting from the fragile statue." And just like that, it was taken away and put in storage.
The Hong Kong Alliance is gone. The Hong Kong University Students' Union is also gone. And today, even the Pillar of Shame is gone. Maybe they just want to erase our memories of the 1989 Tiananmen crackdown. So we must preserve this memory and fight against forgetting.
In previous years, students gathered on June 4th to remember the events in Tiananmen Square. But authorities have now banned them, citing concerns about the COVID-19 pandemic.
Clearly what the Communist Party wants to impose here is a kind of amnesia about what happened in China more than 30 years ago.
The move follows a controversial national security law in Hong Kong last year that outlaws secession, subversion, terrorism and foreign collusion to intervene in the city's affairs. It sparked protests and criticism of Beijing for curtailing freedoms that were promised to Hong Kong when it was handed back to China by Britain in 1997. For now, there is an empty space where the monument once stood. But for many, even though the Pillar of Shame has been removed, the memory of what took place cannot be erased. Asad Beg, Al Jazeera.
Okay, let's bring in Jens Galschiot, who is the sculptor of the Pillar of Shame and joins us from Denmark. Thanks for being on the NewsHour, Jens. Before we get to your reaction on the destruction of the statue, I'd really like you to talk us through the significance of this work for you and what you were trying to convey when you were creating it.
Yes, I created for about 25 years ago to make a memory about something the government don't want to memory. And then I put it in Hong Kong together with the Chinese Democracy Movement. And then just before China took over in Hong Kong. And this was the only possibility to get a monument about the Tiananmen crackdown in 89 inside China. So China take over in Hong Kong and take Hong Kong into the country and the Pillar of Shame. So since then, Hong Kong, mainland China has been really angry on the monument and trying to get rid of this. So this is a 50 bodies who are, this is a death monument. This is a monument about the death and what happened in Tiananmen in 89.
Jens, this sculpture belongs to you personally and it was loaned to the university. So what do you make of its removal and potential destruction?
This is a really strange case, and I think it's a kind of attack against fairness, because I offer them for 2 months, 3 months, I have offered them with my lawyer and offered them in a lot of letters and in a lot of press, and we are saying we will go down to take it down and keep it away and put it back to Europe without problem. And then here, in the middle of nowhere, 2 days before Christmas, in the darkness, they make a lot of, there was 50 guards around it, and a lot of construction workers. And I think this is not really not fair to do this kind of thing. This is a catastrophe. This is a brutal way to do that.
Are you concerned about the damage to the sculpture as well?
Yes, I have to take a look on all the video I have seen, and I can see a big part of the sculpture is still intact in some way. I can't see the single part of the sculpture, but I'm quite sure this is not able to do to take it down on this way to do that without damage it. So, of course, there is a lot of damage on the sculpture. And this is a problem because it's my property, private property. And there is some rule about that. So I think the Hong Kong University has made a crime. We take it down the private property of a foreign artist. So I think they have a big problem with doing that.
Jens, the university says the decision was based on external legal advice and risk assessment. Do you not see those as valid reasons for its removal?
I think they have broken the system. Excuse, this is not secure to have the sculpture. But it's not right. We have technical people who have taken a look at that. I have been there for 8 years ago to repair it. So there's no problem at all. And we have a permission to stay there. And now they come to say, okay, you haven't permission to stay there, but we have been there for 25 years. They have making a ground of cement and concrete and all this kind of thing. And now they say, you have not a permission to stay there. Of course we have a permission. So this case, and this they will do, they will make an attack against the democracy movement, against freedom of expression in Hong Kong. This is what it is about. They will say, you are not allowed to say nothing like the Communist Party in China is against. Don't say nothing about the Jianming, don't say nothing about Xinjiang, don't say nothing about the Muslims of China. So this is the reason to do that, I think.
Well, it will be interesting to see how this story unfolds in the coming weeks and months. Thank you for taking the time to speak to us on this NewsHour, Jens Golshiot, the sculptor of the Pillar of Shame. Thank you.
Thank you.
前支聯會副主席周幸彤被指去年在網上呼籲市民參加六四集會，被裁定煽惑他人參與未經批准集結罪成，判囚15个月，部分同其他案件分期執行，總刑期22个月。康文慧報導。
因前年六四非法集結案服刑中的周幸彤由囚車押送到西九龍裁判法院應訊，他被控在去年5月29日至6月4日期間，在 Facebook、Twitter 和明報發表文章，煽惑他人明知而參與未經批准集結罪。他早前否認控罪。周幸彤自辯的時候說，公安條例中並沒有公共衛生一環，認為警方禁止公眾集會是一個越權的決定。裁判官陳慧敏裁決指，鑑於疫情，公共安全涵蓋範圍廣泛，包括對公眾生命和身體健康構成的風險和威脅。對於被告指文章是沒有地點，只有點起燭光的字眼，法庭認為他是推卸責任。堅守陣地一詞以支聯會舉辦集會31年的背景，以及被告以支聯會副主席的身份發文，明顯是指違憲。被告在庭上的講法是轉移視線，抵賴事實，又說被告的文章亦都有瓜田李下之嫌，說他經過計算和策劃令人留下深刻的印象，而選擇在社交平台發文，用意明顯是要加快傳開去，盡快煽惑多些人去維園，目的是引起公眾參與，意圖超然若揭，裁定周幸彤煽惑他人參與未經批准集結罪名成立。由於周幸彤等候另一件案件審訊期間犯案，屬於加刑因素，法庭判他監禁15个月，其中10个月同前年六四非法集結案的刑期分期執行，總刑期是22个月。
周幸彤求情期間讀出部分六四死難者家屬的文章，遭到裁判官阻止，認為那些是政治論述。期間在公眾席有人拍手和高聲呼叫，有大概10个人被庭警要求離開和抄低他們的身份證。 NTV 記者何文慧報導。